On Story is brought to you in part by the Alice Kleberg Reynolds Foundation. Innovative funding since 1979. On Story, presented by Austin Film Festival. Welcome to a look behind the scenes at the creative process with some of the film industry's most prolific writers, directors, and producers, as well as a showcase of short films from the region's most promising filmmakers.
People say you make such strange movies. You know, you make comedies with kids, you make violent action movies. Like, well, if you look at them, they're all fantasies. None of my movies are realistic. Guys shooting machine guns through guitar cases and woman with a machine gun leg, you have no idea how she can fire it. It's all just unbridled movie making from the id. It makes sense the moment you're watching it, and then makes no sense after it. And it's just, it's dream imagery. So yeah, you can get away with quite a bit, and it's an exploration of that that I find fun. I never really wanted to live in the real world. I like just creating your own world and your own rules in the film world. And that serves as a catharsis for the audience, any type of action or violence.
Watchmen is not an action-heavy story. It's not about that. It's about sort of the twisted psychology of the characters in the world. The ending of the book involves a giant space squid that is, what do you call it? It's a giant interdimensional space squid that is the antagonist of the movie, teleports this huge dead creature into the middle of Times Square, killing thousands upon thousands of people. And it's sort of, you know, this has long been a debate about the graphic novel Watchmen. Does that come out of nowhere? Is that sort of an unusual choice? And yet the images are so great and the story is so great anyways. You know, people love it. So, but I signed my first contract for Watchmen on September 10th, 2001. And the next day, essentially the ending of Watchmen happened to Manhattan. And so most of the time I was writing, I was in sort of a strange situation where it's like, okay, I have to engineer a huge attack on Manhattan that brings the whole world together against a common enemy, which, you know, happened for about 24 hours after September 11th. Then we screwed that up. So as far as those images go of the giant space squid in the end, there's these incredible images of just thousands upon thousands of dead bodies in Times Square and people lying halfway out of buildings and stuff. And it's like, as much as I love that as a comic fan, I didn't want to see that. It was too painful even for me to try to put, especially New Yorkers, to try to put them through that. I didn't think was fair. Plus, I felt like, you know, if you're going to lose the people, they should just be vaporized, maybe turned into the Hiroshima shadows, which is an element, the thematic element of the book.
Whether it's sci-fi or not, you basically take a character or characters and you say, how do I express what they want? And the first X-Men movie, the movie actually starts with Rogue touching this guy, and he has this very adverse reaction to it. So clearly, you're already articulating, here's a character who wants to be able to have some physical or emotional contact with somebody else. If you can, by page three, give us a clear sense of what your character wants, it doesn't matter if they're going to be fighting replicants the entire time or rolling around in the vast, post-apocalyptic world, looking for Detrius. But that's kind of your goal, whether it's sci-fi or not.
When sci-fi gets, because sci-fi is an entire other world, you can make the characters a little bit more broad and more what some people would call a cliche, but some cliches are cliches because they're true universally. Again, in the case of Transformers, we sold that pitch based on the idea that a car for a teenager at 16, when you get a license, represents adulthood, sexuality, freedom. That's something we all go through. All of us wanted to get a car at some point. So that entry point is something we all know. So if you can find those kinds of tent poles to really hang your sci-fi on, then you're onto something. Same with what we did on Star Trek. You open literally on the birth of a child, you know, and even though it's in space and it's whatever, it's a family drama going on.
What is it?
It's a boy.
A boy? Tell me about him.
He's beautiful. George, you should be here.
Impact alert.
What are we gonna call him?
We can name him after your father.
Tiberius, you kidding me? No, that's the worst. Let's name him after your dad. Let's call him Jim.
Jim. Okay, Jim it is.
Sweetheart, can you hear me?
I
love you so much.
So you want to relate it as much as you can to something common in our experiences, and then take it where you want to take it.
When you write a sci-fi film, I always feel like you get one leap. You've got one magical leap that you're given that the audience will buy. In Star Wars, it's the Force. If you buy the Force, you'll buy Star Wars. In X-Men, it's the X gene. If you have the X gene, you can turn into anything. You can develop any powers. And these are the things that open the doors for you. In Watchmen, the piece of magic is Dr. Manhattan. He gets created and throws the whole world off its kilter. He, for those who don't know, he gets blown apart, and then he puts himself back together as basically a godlike creature who can change the physical realities of anything, the particles of reality.
You know, there was a bit in Star Trek where we were trying to explain trans warp drive because it's a plot, and basically what Bob and Alex came up with was some version of Scotty saying, you know, well, it's basically like shooting a bullet from a riding horse in an effort to shoot another bullet. In other words, it's hard, you know?
Right.
It's really hard, trans warp drive. Look over here. Over here. Look over here. It's hard. You know, if you actually try to explain the mechanics behind beaming someone from A to B, everyone will be, you know, heading to get some popcorn. So, because it has nothing to do with the plot or the emotion. Again, to return to X-Men, you know, or any superhero movie, there's this cool idea of like, wow, wouldn't it be great if I were a superhero? And I think what's so cool about the migration from Superman, which is the first superhero movie I saw, to superhero movies these days is, it shows you the wish fulfillment, but it also shows you the reality of, wow, this is what it would really be like if you were Batman. You know, that it would actually kind of suck too. And you, and you'd have to, if you actually wanted to be Batman, what kind of fucked up individual would you have to be to do that, to put that suit on and go and fight people? So I find that very, very interesting. And since we're all, you know, kind of, you know, dark individuals in our own hearts, that's what you know, that's what you write.
Yeah, practical tip number one is metaphor. If you can come up with a good metaphor that's that substitute for the science equation. The second thing is, if you can get out exposition of that sort somehow in a fight, that's always a great trip. In Star Trek, we did it. It's like, it's not just, we time travel. It's like, they're time traveling, you idiot. We're all going to die if we don't figure this out. So if you can bury it in an emotion, you'll sneak it past the audience.
You have to understand who you are as a, you know, as an artist or as a writer. You have to understand where your passions lie. And, you know, it was Star Wars that changed my life and Raiders of the Lost Ark. And, you know, I was a young boy when, during the advent of Steven Spielberg. And so that had a great impact on me, Jim Cameron, people like this. And so, you know, I was never going to be the type of writer who wrote Ordinary People or Kramer versus Kramer. I get very, I mean, I appreciate those movies when they're done well, but I hate when they're not done well and you're just watching a bunch of people complain about their lives. I would rather have the stakes be huge. I'd rather have the world be threatened. I'd rather have all the fun and the toys and the spaceships and the battles and all of that, and equate that to the battles in our lives.
Steven wanted to do a James Bond movie and couldn't get one. And Steven said to him, George said to him, I have a better thing than George, James Bond. He says, it's like the old serials and his adventure in the 30s, and it's like the serial, like all adventure movies and serials put together, and he's going to be named after my dog, Indiana. And Phil Kaufman, who's a wonderful director, made the right stuff and a bunch of other stuff. When he was 11 years old, his orthodontist had told him about the Lost Ark of the Covenant. And so Phil, that was Phil's contribution to this, because at one point Phil was going to direct this. And the thing they should be chasing, the McGovern, should be this Lost Ark of the Covenant, which none of us had heard about. Then Phil had fallen out of the project, and that's all they knew, really. He had a whip and a hat and stuff. And this is a very short conversation, and I was excited to be there, and Frank Marshall, who had never produced anything with George, was there. And after about 15 minutes, George stood up, and this was very uncharacteristic of him. I didn't know this at the time because I didn't know him. And he said, all right, let's do this. And let's, he came out from behind his desk and he said, let's all shake hands. Maybe this is a historic moment. And so we did. I think that was the last time George ever did anything like that. Maybe the last time we shook hands. And then, so Frank and I were dismissed, Frank Marshall, and we're walking out and Frank said, do you think we got that job? And I said, I don't know. I guess when we get home, if the agents call, we got the job. And we got home, and the agents did call. So I spent 6 months writing Raiders of the Lost Ark. And when I was done, he asked me to write Empire Strikes Back. And then when that was over, people wanted me to write things. It's just like happened with John. You get very hot all of a sudden. And I said, no, I'm not writing anything more. I'm going to direct. And Alan Ladd Jr. was running Fox. He said, well, what do you want to direct? And I said, I told him the story of Body Heat. And it sort of all went like that very quickly. And I was really lucky, really lucky. And we had very little time to do it. And Irvin Kershner was the director, and he's a wonderful director. He had been a teacher of George's at SC and had made The Eyes of Laura Mars and some other very dark modern dramas. And he was an unusual pick to do this science fiction movie, but he was, you know, brilliant at it, and a lot of people think he did the best job of all of them. And he was very involved in this intense writing period, and they were already building the sets, and they had done the storyboarding, and all they needed was a story, characters, dialogue. So that was fun. But I think I didn't know anything about science. My brother had been a big science fiction reader, you know, he was that era. And I was not that interested in it. But what I was interested in was character and adventure. And those movies had been very important to me, the movies of Howard Hawks and John Ford and Anthony Mann and John Sturges. And I felt that was really the essence of both Raiders and the Star Wars saga was, you know, the onward rush of events. And within that context, the revelation of character, you know, and that's really where the fun comes. Because these extraordinary things are happening. They're happening very fast. There's very little time for reflection. But which, if anything, in my own work, there's too much time for reflection. So it was great to be working in a genre where there's no time for that. And you wind up, and I've done more of it, and I've done some lately for other people. And you realize that the actual time you have in the screenplay to create characters is minute. Yeah, there's so much time taken up with moving the hardware around and getting through the basic gags, you know, which is the call, you know, this time travel, this superpower, whatever. It leaves very little time in the screenplay to create anything that resembles an identifiable personality, you know. So that's a challenge of it. And but it was a good exercise for me because my own scripts were all character and very little of that.
Hi, I'm Miguel Alvarez. I am a local filmmaker in Austin, Texas, and I am the writer and director of the short film Tadpoles. The original idea for the film came from a short passage in the novel 100 Years of Solitude. In it, there's this old colonel who's reminiscing about the time that he first saw somebody die. When he was a kid, he sees his prisoner shot by a firing squad. And I was struck by that, you know, by this idea of a kid and this loss of innocence and how that affects somebody, especially when they're older. And so I thought, okay, I want to write a story somewhat similar. So the interesting thing about the film is that there's no dialogue in it. I wanted, you know, the story is about, you know, loss of innocence, particularly through an act of war. And I wanted something that could be really seen universally, you know, no matter where it's seen, it's something that, you know, that the ideas get across. I was also sort of, I wanted to challenge myself to tell a story visually without any words, because film, you know, it's essentially a visual medium, and the idea of just telling a story through nothing but moving pictures, moving images, was something that I wanted to challenge myself with. Coming up next is my film Tadpoles. Thanks for watching.
On Story, presented by Austin Film Festival. A look behind the scenes at the creative process with some of the film industry's most prolific writers, directors, and producers, as well as a showcase of short films from the region's most promising filmmakers. On the next On Story, writers Roberto Orci and David Hayter, and filmmaker Robert Rodriguez.